Welcome everybody, enjoy your meal, and have a nice time. And I hope that while eating you can listen to some stuff about glass that I prepared for you. And name of this lesson was originally Everything You Ever Wanted to Know About Rendering Glass, Not Only with Cycles. But my wife saw the title of this lesson and she said, oh, what a megalomaniac and boring name, you know, it's like everybody names things like this. And okay, so I had to do this, and so I named it internally just to a few tricks that I learned. And it's like there is quite a lot of tutorials about how to render glass. And I simply try to cover topics that are not covered in these tutorials that are prominent on YouTube. And this is like how to render water in a glass or some other tutorials that are covered. And I try to find the topics that are not covered. So these are just few small tricks. And first thing, I will write down, like, when you're rendering something that is translucent or has glass, it's not only glass, it's also water, of course, and other materials, then is to know something about rays, about how they intersect, which I will show you later, because it helps you to set up things correctly. Then setting up shaders, that's the main topic of this lesson, and avoiding some mistakes in modeling, because some details on glass elements can screw up how things look. And solving noise and fireflies, I made this with a line because also that's what is covered quite well in other tutorials. And rendering caustics, I won't cover it by half that I don't know how to do it in VidCycles. And that it's also covered in some tutorial by Gleb Alexandrov, I think, and in some shader that was presented yesterday in the talks, in the 5-minute talks. First thing is, I made my job to check other artists' work. I see a lot of what other artists do, and I realized there are some very common mistakes that artists do, and one is color of the glass shader. And it's kind of fixed in 2.80, because if you add glass shader, its color is set to 100% white. But in 2.79, a lot of people were adding glass and the color was not white, actually. It was a bit gray, and that's what you get in the principal shader. So that's just the first very basic thing, that if you make glass with principal shader, remember to set it completely white. I see this really often. Also, some advanced artists do it just because they're not focused on it. And here is glass rendering that looks almost good, but I think something strange with it. And I see this also quite often. And there's something problematic in this render. Do you see what it is? Why? Well, it's this area, and it's black. And if you would take a photo of such an area, this would not happen. Like, it can happen if there are some black objects in the space that you are photographing, that they somehow the blackness gets there. But usually, the case why this appears is the ray depth. And it's interesting that this is the default settings in Blender, the ray depth. Simply meant, for those who don't know, it's how many times a sample or a ray can go through some point where it either reflects or goes through the surface. And it's interesting that at the default of this black area in the glass are not, you would guess glass is where the rays go through, okay? So I will increase the rays that should go through to get rid of this black area. But in reality, it's mostly the glossy samples. I will show in a moment why. And then there are sometimes it's the transmission rays, of course, too, but the glossy samples are more at fault because of internal reflections inside of glass. And of course, then there are total arrays. And here I will show why it's the glossy arrays. Okay. By the way, this animation was rendered with Blender because I didn't find any other software that could simulate optical effects like this. And this is some very regular shape, and we can see that the what happens is not that complex. Mainly, there is a ray coming through. Some part of the ray reflects, some part reflects inside and back and goes outside. But in total, we could count one or two or three depths of the rays. And here comes another shape, and I changed it just a little. I made just a little bump in this shape. And it's a bit slow, sorry. What we see that already there are things happening that are much more complex than before in the simple shape. And that's because if sometimes when rays get inside a shape like this, they get trapped inside because internal reflection of glass is much more strict than the external. You can see that inside of this glass shape, basically, once the ray comes in, it almost doesn't get out, especially in the first shape. And it's because the index of refraction inside of glass is the opposite as if the ray comes from outside. So the light ray basically gets trapped. So there are like, for example, four transmission depths in this example. But regarding glossy, it can be over 20, 40. And okay. So one way to fix this is this. especially interior artists will say, oh, this is a great solution. let's spend the rest of our lives rendering. Here I made an animation, what happens, and this is external lighting, okay, I made this easy for me. What happens and how many rays do you need to get to the point where the glass is really nice and shiny. And it kind of keeps counting, and here I increase both the glossy and transmission rays, but generally it can be improved mostly only with the glossy ray settings. Okay. And around 30 I can see that that's enough, 30, in an open environment. Okay. So, yeah. Here is a little example from some job I did, and here actually the reflections were much more because it's droplets, and as I showed the irregular shape, I was like really confused what is happening. There was, and I back then I didn't know how to solve it otherwise, so I set just the reflections and reflections crazy high, and now I have this simple solution to it. And it's basically like checking the ray depth, and after some ray depth, telling the shader that the ray can get out. But it's the ray depth of, I in my test, around 10 is good, because if you have more glass objects, until some depth, there are glasses behind each other, the eye would recognize that basically the next glass disappeared, or but after several refractions, you cannot see it because it's just too many objects behind the other and you don't have to care. So this is quite simple, that after a certain ray depth, and I have here greater than, you switch from glass to transparent shader, and the ray gets out and it's happily shiny white or whatever. And okay, here's a detail for those who didn't see it. And this is another animation I did, and this is basically ray depth with this shader, and like when, like the stop condition, like which I set to 10. So I can see that when I come to 0 to 5, where this ends, it looks okay, and the black areas are there, the whole glass piece is shiny. So. And that's it. that's the main magic.
I think you keyed out the black spots
Yes, yes. This is the way to kill the black spots and keep the whole glass shiny. Like, yeah. It's. I found it to be quite universal, usable. But these are some common modeling mistakes on glass that happen, and again here the depth is set quite not that high, but quite high already, and you can see that the border of the glass looks a bit weird. Like some glasses are actually manufactured like this, so it might be correct. Also, but the traditional glassmakers make a little shape on the edge of the glass that goes like this. It's better on the lip when you drink from it, but also it's the reason is that the edge of the glass looks shinier somehow. So the to the left there are three solutions that I sometimes see. First one is like very badly applied subdivision surface modifier with no extra edges added close to the border of the glass. The second is basically making sharp edges using edge crease. And the third solution is adding edges close to the top, but not making the bulge. So you have the edge of the glass and you just add two loops below. So that makes the subdivision surface modifier do a nice round shape. But if you do the bulging, it looks slightly better in my opinion. Here is the same render with more light rays, and especially in the first case, there is still something wrong. Like the others look kind of okay or better. Yeah, this is the detail of it. And here is the correct solution where there are actually more loops below the edge. Okay, let's go further. Now, I wanted to speak about sheet of glass and why, if you have a sheet of glass, is it green from the side? And it's such a big difference and if you look from front and from the side. Because at first sight it doesn't make much logic to me. So, but this animation shows quite clearly what is happening. If you have a sheet of glass and you look from front, yeah, like before I said, glass is actually, I said in the beginning that the glass is white, and glass is actually mostly green, but it can be also, of course, many different colors. But the pure glass we are used to see as pure, clear glass has some impurities, and it's usually green from some metals or some stuff like this, and it's only visible when the glass is really thick. So if it's 1 meter thick or 2 meters thick, then it can be really green. And what happens if you have this glass sheet and from the front? Okay. I will come back a bit because this animation also explains the Fresnel effect. But basically, in the beginning, yeah, there is the light ray that comes through mostly, and it spends very small amount of time in the glass. Of course, some is reflected, and here you can see that the reflection ray is much weaker than the ray that comes through. And because of the index of refraction effect and how these things work, like the more there is an angle, the less of light comes through and the more is reflected. Okay, there is also some dispersion here, but you can ignore it. I made it just to make it look more beautiful. So here you can see quite clearly the Fresnel effect and what happens. But sorry. Okay, and this is what happens from the side. If the ray goes straight, okay, this is not. If the ray goes straight, it's quite simple. It spends, like, let's say this is 1 meter wide. It spends 1 meter in the glass. But when it goes under an angle, there comes again this trapping of the light inside, and basically now the ray does go double the distance. So the glass is actually more green if you look under an angle than if you look straight, which is kind of weird, but that's it. Yeah. Okay. I have. Here I have just recorded an example of applying these things to a model of one artist. I hope he's not angry with me, but I noticed like that there are some things that could be fixed on it, and it's not. Yeah, it's like this. Okay, sorry, it plays now. Okay, and in the first moment you can see that there's a lot of blackness in there, and I try actually not to fix it with the rays. I somehow in this live session I tried to set up the rays, but I just increased it to total 24 because it's also not good to have 24 rays in your if you are in interior. This is exteriorly lighted just again so that I can show it. The first thing is that the artist didn't add these loops to the edges of the table. It was just a plane that has a solidify modifier and some bevel added, but like just the shape of the glass, which wasn't visible, and the normals that it generates was really spreading this black spot inside of the table. And now when I added the loops, you can see it's limited to the side. Now I will just use some preset that has already this in it, and basically this is the same preset I used before. It's just that after 12 rays or 10, I don't know, like this setting just below your ray depth setting so that it can get out, the ray becomes green. And then you have this effect that with the glass, this is really like lightweight considering like the effect. And you don't have to, because I saw, for example, some tutorials where people said, okay, if you want it like this, then from the side, make another material and make it green glass. Okay, and here you don't have to care about it. You can just apply this material to whatever I want. So I like just tried to. I forgot to say this preset has one more thing, and that is, I hope. I'm sorry, I'm really not able to do live sessions, so I recorded this because it's for me too hard to talk and do something on a computer. Unlike Lech Sokolovsky, who made the previous lesson, and he's really good at it and can do everything like this. And here you can see there is also some volume absorption added. And that is, again, because this effect would stop working if you look straight on the glass. And in the animation, you might get over this border, and there still might happen some little jump in the shader if you animate it. So maybe there could be some blending in the material, but I wanted to keep it simple for this lesson. Okay. I'll just make it a bit faster. And here I wanted to show, I just tried to apply the same thing to another object in the scene, just to test that it works, that you can see that the glass again looks quite good. I'm not sure if it would be that green, and it's such a small plate, but it has its limits, but it's a nice trick, I think. Okay, next topic is architecture glass. If you have been to previous lesson, then there was, I think, like 10 ways how to do architectural glass. So this is just one of them, and it's repetition if you saw it already. Again, like the theory behind is this, again, the same thing here, that if you have this ray, like on the other side of glass, it continues in the same direction. So if it's like if there was no refraction at all, of course, if the glass is manufactured perfectly. So if you want to go for real realism, there are some imperfections, especially in old glass, because the glass flows like a fluid. So 100 old glass will be really bended. But if you take like the perfect glass for architectural visualization, the ray on the other side continues just the same, just 1 millimeter to the side or something, which is really not visible. So that's why It's saved to... Sorry, the presentation got stuck somehow. Yeah, and the Fresnel effect is there again. It's, yeah, okay. Sorry, the presentation didn't work out like it, I wanted, but it's easy to skip the glass completely. And that's where you use only Fresnel and glossy effect. Glossy shader is same like showed 1 hour ago, and you mix it with transparent. So what goes through is transparent, and that saves computing time. And this is what I have a bit different, that I also made some other like conditions for light rays that I subtract from the Fresnel. If it's a shadow, diffuse, transmission, reflection ray, and based on the ray depth, which is on the ray depth, it's this multiply. It's this multiply box. You see it? It's where I multiply the ray depth by 0.1 or 0.2. So if there would be more glasses behind each other, each would be more transparent, which is not realistic and maybe not good. But if you would have a scene where there are 10 glasses behind each other, then it could like be really hard for cycles. So that's it. And yeah, that's end of the presentation. I'm not sure what is the time because I think I wanted to make a little live session about the dispersive glass, which is like a really different topic. I would use it only for jewelry, like, and sincerely, like, the animations I showed, the ones that have these refractions, were done with LuxCore, which is much better with caustics. And if you would want to render the jewelry, like this specific case with dispersive glass, I would go this way probably. Because LuxCore, I was surprised myself, but it really moves forward. You just install the plugin and it takes cycles materials and is able to use them to some extent. Not all the procedural nodes and stuff, but if you go with textures and simple stuff, then LuxCore can do this job. But I wanted to show this, it's called dispersive diamond shader. And it's not glass, it's diamond. Because I sincerely don't know where. Yeah, there might be cases where it's good for glass, but so I think I will try to do this material from scratch because it's better to see it how it's created. Let's hope I don't forget. If I forget something, I can help myself again. So I first do an RGB color input because I will show later why, and I will try with converters to separate RGB, and that's how we fake the dispersion in the glass. That first I do separate RGB and I do combine RGB. This is the most lightweight way to do this, like to get actually three colors from one, I guess, because it's just switching the channels, no math in it. And now I have this color input that I make white, as I said, to three colors. And I now can add three glass shaders. It's quite heavy because there are three shaders in it, so, oh, sorry. And these shaders get added together because we split the color, so we will combine it back by adding. Sorry. something comes out, but I'm quite sure it will be just the normal glass, because now we need to change index of refraction. The point is that index of refraction for the different color lens is different. So, but to make it guidable, so I don't have to set the three shaders separately, I will make some values for this. Oh, where did it fly? Sorry. Okay, I add it again. Okay. It's around 2.5 for a diamond, and I also make another input for the amount of dispersion, which I tried before, and 0.05 is okay. And I also make another value to drive the roughness of the result, which I will show you later why this is needed. Okay. Now, the first is my IOR, and I want to take this IOR three times, one for red, one for green, one for blue. And I want to take the math mode, so for red, I will subtract this, basically the ref, this difference in the dispersion. And for the blue, I will add it. And now, so the first value goes to error, if I'm correct. The second value is the basic value of IOR, it's the middle. And the third value goes from this opposite, yeah, subtract, add, and the middle. They all go here to these shaders. Okay, let's look how this looks now. And I can see, okay, there is some dispersion happening, but the whole thing renders slowly and it's very dark. So here I recommend to light to cycles a bit about the physical properties of light and to put in 1.05 into the color or something like that, or maybe even more. With this material, I also found out because of cycles, let's say it, but also another ray tracers, the roughness of zero is not good because this will just create endless noise. So I try to connect the roughness value and it also makes the whole thing much more shiny. Sincerely, I don't know why, but increasing roughness makes it get more light out of it. It's like with the mirror material in cycles. Like if you make mirror, it literally reflects nothing and it throws no light. Okay. And yeah, 0.05 is fine for this. And this diamond looks okay. Yeah. Okay. That's it. Oh, I think it's half an hour, so it's nice. Are there some questions? Yeah, let's try. I didn't. Yeah, it works. Yeah, if I can make it lower the highlight. Not outside, but only inside.
Yes, the one that uh-huh.
I didn't try it so that I would get lost here, but probably after some rays. Like to tell, hey, after one or two rays, it's different. So like this, or maybe also like add a shader. It's sometimes good to, make, for example, have the same shader added to itself. Like that's what I also use sometimes. It will ruin the setup, but let's say that I say if the rays are higher than 2, I can just not like this. I can just do this, and then you can use the same shader computation. You don't make more shaders and make it more heavy, and then you can basically make also this math higher. And sometimes, you can reuse same computation from the shader. Okay, that's it. Thank you very much.